Penguin Random House Audio presents Big Macs and Burgundy, Wine Pairings for the Real World, by Vanessa Price with Adam Laukhuf. This is the author, Vanessa Price. For Brianna. Once, in the wilds of Afghanistan, I lost my corkscrew, and we were forced to live on nothing but food and water for days. W.C. Fields. Hello, stranger. Pull up a corkscrew. Sancerre is a town in the Loire Valley of France that produces benchmark Sauvignon Blanc, with crazy acidity, pure minerality, and cheek-puckering citrus. It goes perfectly with Cheetos. I know this because I have paired Sauvignon Blanc with Taco Bell's entire menu, the country's most popular movie candy, almost everything in the supermarket frozen food aisle, including Hot Pockets Philly steak and cheese, with and without croissant crust, and pretty much every other mass-produced foodstuff you can think of. And returned from the field with one of the most important enophilic discoveries of our time. Sancerre and Cheetos go together like milk and cookies. It's a pairing so deceptively and fundamentally delicious, it has eluded almost every wine expert colleague I know, right up until the moment they polish off a bag and a bottle for themselves. The sense science behind this unholy alliance of artificially flavored puffed cornmeal and serious wine is as elemental as acid, fat, salt, and minerals. The very same principles that explain the harmonious bond between oysters and Chablis, or filet mignon and Napa Cab. In fact, I've spent the better part of 15 years in the wine industry as a trained sommelier, thinking about exactly what makes pairings work, then testing and retesting my craziest hypotheses on unsuspecting friends and loved ones. I turned some of that hard-earned knowledge into a column for New York Magazine's Grub Street, and the enthusiastic response I've received from listeners like you has only confirmed what I've known for a long time. There's a whole world of entirely fun, entirely accessible, and often entirely counterintuitive wine pairings out there waiting to be discovered. It's also been a constant reminder that there's an entire planet full of people who love wine as much as I do, but have never had the opportunity to learn about it the right way, through informed experimentation. They're the same people who might drink 3 or 4 different bottles per week, or more during a pandemic, yet are so turned off by the inaccessible snobbery of wine speak that they generally avoid it altogether. Sound familiar? If so, this audiobook is for you. As someone who has been lucky enough to experience some of the greatest chef sommelier tasting menus in the world, I can say with certainty that you don't need truffle-dusted sunchokes or sous-vide pheasant loins to unlock the joys of a fabulous or even just plain good bottle of wine. It can be done gloriously with something as basic as funfetti cake. There are exceptional pairings to be had almost anywhere, from the local gas station snack rack to your favorite Grubhub guilty pleasure order. The art of pairing food with wine is not without its mysteries, but it's far from a mystical trick of culinary alchemy. At its most basic, it's the informed process of combining complementary flavors and textures, either through contrast or accentuation, to create perfect balance. And when you get it just right, your palate finds equilibrium with each swallow. If your food has a lot of fat, it needs a sharp, acidic wine to cut through it. If it has heat and spice, a high-sugar wine will soften the intensity. Bitter foods want something deep and lush to counteract them, while certain rich and powerful dishes can call for congruent pairings, which means doubling down on all the attributes that make something delicious to begin with. The same rule of congruency applies to fresh and citrusy fare. Your ideal wine will reflect that light, bright character. As you'll learn throughout these chapters, a great food and wine pairing both heightens and, to a degree, cancels out its counterpart. It's a principle that's been put into practice for thousands of years in the Mediterranean, where wine and food have long worked in symbiosis. While wines from the land of Dionysus may seem tannic, tart, or too sweet by themselves, Greek table varieties take on an entirely different and uncommonly satisfying character when consumed with certain kinds of food, The zesty sting of Santorini yields to charred octopus, while Retsina, an exotic resinated wine with undercurrents of pine, is tempered by spicy lamb. That's what food-friendly wine means. I didn't make this term up, I promise. And don't worry, by the time we're done, you'll understand that concept completely. In the Burgundy region of France, they'll serve you white Burgundy with Gougère, a savory puff pastry filled with a nutty cheese, typically Gruyère or Comté, which blends uncannily with the French oak creaminess of their wine. And if you ask them how long they've been pairing those two things, they'll say, forever. It's been going on for that many centuries. Pairing in the modern sense, as an expensive gastronomic experience, has only really been a thing since the 1980s. That's when paired dishes and wines started appearing on the menus of fancy restaurants, usually in set-price, multi-course dinners with specific wines matched to individual dishes. For the most part, pairings have remained in that rarefied realm of tasting menus ever since, depriving the rest of us of one of life's purest pleasures. As I'll explain more deeply later, Sancerre works so well with Cheetos because of its salinity, light body, and raw bite. It makes sense that the only grape that stands a chance against Chester's finger-staining orangey salt powder is the rip-roaring acidity of white Sancerre, which has the added benefit of being highly textured, meaning that when you swish it around, it coats your mouth, giving it a fighting chance against all that Cheetos buildup. Each of the fleshy areas of your mouth, from the gums to the tongue to the roof and all the way back to your throat, provide sensory feedback to your brain, which lights up with pleasure when processing this kind of robust data. White Sancerre also has a lot of what we in the business call minerality, that category of smells and flavors that aren't fruity, spicy, or herbal, but rather flinty or chalky. Think of the subtle brine of an oyster or of licking a rock. Sancerre's minerality keeps the explosiveness of the nacho cheese in check. Similar principles are at work in the shockingly delicious marriage of s'mores and recioto della Valpolicella, Sour Patch Kids and semi-dry Riesling, and you guessed it, Big Macs and Burgundy. It is beautiful and surprising combinations like these, freed from the tyranny of three-figure ingredients and white tablecloths that excite me most. And I'm pretty sure they'll excite you too. Of course, it's not just about dollar pizza and Montepulciano, which you should definitely try. It's also about the fresh, simple, and clean foods that you eat the rest of the time because you're a normal, healthy person. Even the blandest Netflix night grilled chicken with steamed broccoli can be made sublime with the right glass of wine. What follows are pairings that will make you smile and open your mind to new possibilities, with plenty of rut-breaking varieties you may have never considered. If you like Sauvignon Blanc, let's get you on the Verdicchio train. Drinking a lot of Chianti? Try tracking down a Mondeuse Noir. And you can also apply the specific pairings in this audiobook to your broader culinary circumstances. For instance, the next time you see a Chablis on the wine list at the hottest new Japanese spot, you'll know exactly what to do with it. Because you already know that it goes perfectly with seaweed snacks and that mineral-driven whites are good with seafood, it's probably going to be a stellar match for that sushi special roll. That's the look of your date being totally impressed. And those are the moments I live for. When I see students or friends feeling confident enough to make the leap and apply what they've learned on their own terms, there's no better feeling. Except for when I get to eat and drink their discoveries. Wine inspires me, and by the end of this audiobook, I hope it will inspire you, too. But just who the hell am I spouting all of this life-changing knowledge? Well, you're going to get to know me and the story of how I came to wine and how it changed my life. And hopefully, little by little, you'll start to trust me enough to lend me your summer house in France. I'm going to tell you about the time I served Sancerre to Justin Bieber and his entourage at a club in Montauk, about how I made it in one of the most cutthroat and depraved industries in one of the most cutthroat and depraved cities in the world. about how the very same girl who once thought she was a serious wine collector because she had a kitchen shelf stocked with Arbor Mist somehow found herself sitting with the owners of Cristal Champagne, giving menu notes to the world-famous chef, Eric Repair, at his 3-star Michelin restaurant, Le Bernardin. And how it all pretty much comes down to Matt Damon. But the first thing you need to know is just how improbable it is that I'm a sommelier at all. I was born and raised a Southern Baptist in Louisville, Kentucky.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.